Hello everybody, ladies and gentlemen. In the presence of the author, the editor, guests and representatives of the public, I have the pleasure to address some words of welcome to this small but no less very fine crowd. A book launch celebrates this very rare exemplar of a book. A real book, not an e-book, but pages put in between a cover with footnotes and comments, a table of content, etc. Buchwissenschaften is the pejorative judgment of the so-called natural sciences. That is why a book launch must be a feast of the humanities. With regard to law, the categorization is not that easy. Is the study of law part of cultural studies, Recht als Kulturwissenschaft, as some say? Is the discipline of legal training embedded in different contexts of legal cultures a favorite topic of our center lawyers' culture? Or is Rechtswissenschaft the discipline promoted and systematized by the university as a bearer of the rationalization of the law, according to Max Weber, a third culture of scientific knowledge? Perhaps we may come back to the question from which kind of standpoint the hard doctrinal work of bringing some clarity in the field of international economic law has been undertaken by the star of this afternoon, Matthias Herdegen. He doesn't need to stand up because everybody knows him in this circle. What is the interest of this center in such a sophisticated and specialized work as that of Matthias Herdegen covering, as we will see in the discussion, such a wide range of topics, from the definition of international economic law to international economic order past and present, the actors and subjects of international economic law, the legal sources of soft and hardcore normative orders and how to understand them as rules, or more elegantly, as principles, digging into world trade law, international business law, sales and contracts, letters of credit, international company and competition, the international law of foreign investment, so important for developing countries, and finally, what makes the world go around since October 15, 2008? International monetary law and the financial architecture of world society. If these are the topics international economic law is about, there are thousands of reasons to be highly interested in knowing more about this area in the universal reign of normativity. Whenever you want to seize what economic globalization and its normative preconditions and consequences are about. As I have the task today to make an introduction to a rather complicated field in which I do not even have the right to regard myself as a specialist, I must allude to the constitutive and creative learning community as a principal aim of the Käte Hamburger colleagues as in general. And this is especially true for the undertaking today in the presence of those distinguished colleagues who shaped some major branches in the very sophisticated discourse about globalization, like Martin Aldrow, through the lens of social sciences, one has to be very modest, but also prepared to hopefully venture onto new path in that difficult field. By now, it is hard to speak of globalization, and please allow me just to remind you of this discourse without assuming too much a mocking tone. Glocalization, globalization, McDonaldization, globalization of nothing, as Ritzer said. The variety of neologism alone is expanding unstoppably without conveying any meaningful information sometimes. If one adds all the tenders of rights to the mix, one has finally called the evil by its name and found an excuse for everything undesirable taking place in our world, excuse me, on our globe, one has to say. So I could go deeper into that, and I could remind you and us that there had debates in the 19th century about globalization with a certain Karl Marx, who offered a great model, theories about globalization in this sense, and criticized the Saint-Simonians and their journal Le Globe just for forgetting to take their living conditions with them when importing their ideas to Germany. Huge international events took place, from the Great Exhibition in London with Paxton's Crystal Palace to the World's Fairs in Paris, St. Louis, and so forth. I could go on in this direction, and even some years before, in a very small town in Germany, there were people at Weimar thinking that they had to do with just 6,000 souls, they had to do with Weltliteratur. So given the above, what are we here for this afternoon? First and foremost, I would like to take this opportunity to address the interdisciplinary circle assembled here on the sociological discourse of globality with the presumption that the legal dimension was not the initial irritant. Nevertheless, these approaches shall be examined as to their affinity to law. In system theory, this immediately yields positive results, but also in other places it offers theoretical breaches through confusing terrain. I should address the repression and later rediscovery of normativity in globalization discourse. This includes the question on where international public law is to be situated in the multidimensional model of globalization of world society. The role of human rights as lodestars of a world value community and its particular cultural variations. We talked about this 2 weeks ago with Matthias Herdegen, exactly. 2 weeks ago, or the Europeanization of family law, we will discuss with Professor Detloff in some weeks. Finally, international criminal law recalls the preconditions for tribunalization without which human law, as humanity law, sorry, as Rudi Teitel calls it, cannot be imposed. And finally, the location of international economic law. In other words, I want to recall a rather lost and forgotten methodological function of the law in the sociological discourse of modernity and post-modernities. That is the indicative function of legal orders for the structure of societies. In Durkheim's time, who fought so much against but also with the law, from his first writings on to the division of labor in society, law was an indicator of the form and extent to which national societies were integrated and not anomic or chaotic. We would do nothing than transfer this function of the law, the methodological function of the law, to the level of world society when asking in how far the ambiguous processes of globalization was mirrored and expressed in the developing system of a global normative order. That would be the special, specific interest of the center in the debate, because our interest can't be just to bring new solutions, normative, doctrinal solutions to the questions you are raising. We are in a way reading the book, or some of us at least, also by way of, or with an interest, to grasp those problems that are behind the normative questions that you try to bring to a solution, and to see what is, what are real conflicts behind, for example, what are the cultural implications of that. So, for example, we could have started just with the Bangladesh case and the question, what does it mean for Ash and M and C I A, or how do you say for this in English? I don't know. What kind of responsibilities would be raised, and that there is a kind of very strong feeling that it is not something out of responsibility has been proved during the last days, when a clear reference was made and a clear point was made that the questions, the code of conduct was implied in this context. And this is a specific type of law we have to deal with when we are dealing in this matter with international economic law. So I think it is important to see that here judicial escapes come back into play, which can be mobilized either for and against the theory of world society and the claim of fragmented world law. It is always the question in how far there are processes of unification and fragmentization and how all this has to be brought together. Questions of comparative theory can be addressed in this context. Even if as vulnerable fields as comparative law and the various disciplines of international law are used to conceptualizing local and translocal normative orders, several theoretical and methodological consequences for legal research oriented towards cultural sociology in a global context still need to be drawn, I think. And we are trying to do that during the year that we are investing in the relationship of normative orders and the process of globalization. I want just to finish with this very, very small introduction by raising some of the questions that are behind the construction of what could be called a global normative order. So if there is, can be talked about a world legal culture is an open question. What kind of symbolical elements, what kind of normative elements, which human rights, reasons for validity and so forth. Pluralism versus unism, particularistic versus universalistic approaches. Plural levels of validity. Organizational questions, what guarantees have been set in place, legal staffing, mediation, codes of conduct, jurisdiction by tribunals, and so forth. To what extent the conception of world legal culture, in turn, influenced by legal cultural traditions? What form of global validity culture is emerging? Conflicts between religious and secular validity cultures that are implied, spaces of the normative order and of normative diversity. And finally, what kind of normativity promises global effectiveness? Law, we had a lot of debates about that. What kind of normativity is really efficient? Is it just the law as we know it? Is it morale? Is it manners? Is it standards? Is it ideas and images of justice about the right and the wrong? Experiences of injustice, as Bakshi and others say. So, and how in this context, as Paul Schiff Berman put the question, how is global pluralism handled in this larger area? These are only some more general questions that arise when globalization and normative ordering are addressed in the same time. So let us come back to the miracle. And the miracle is the birth of a book. Starting with a strong central idea, by an auctorial will to constitute a work to be published by a publisher here present, overcoming all the difficulties of writing that Roland Barthes misleadingly subsumed under the heading of the plaisir du texte, though it is also as inscribed in the picture that must be the next one, some kind of a real suffering. So let us celebrate the victory with a representative of the publishing house, Oxford University Press, who we have the pleasure to host today in the gestalt of Miss Meryl Alstein. the floor is yours when I will have presented you. That was future second. Okay. Meryl Austin studied at the University of Utrecht and at the University of Cambridge, where she was research associate at the Lauterbach Center. That is an important point. And when I have been there lastly 2 years ago, I was really very much impressed by the vibrant climate that is still there at this center, so important for international law. Since 2000, Meryl Austin has held various positions at Oxford University Press and so forth. I stop here, but being now responsible for public international law. As all of you know, the history of Oxford University Press, is that right or not? It was founded when, you know, of course, 1478. Just 2 years after Caxton set up the first printing press in England, so it has to do with the history of printing. And in 1586, the University of Oxford tried to print books was recognized in a decree from the Star Chamber. Well, this is important to know, and it goes on. And interestingly enough, that not only books were published in England and in Oxford especially, but the first office, overseas office in New York, opened in 1896. And other international branches followed, including Canada, Australia, and India. And Indian Oxford University Press is very familiar, at least to my research, and Southern Africa, by the way, in 14. So there is a new process at Oxford University Press to come back and to resemble, as far as I know and understood. Very interesting in any case, but now the floor is yours. Very welcome at our center, and thank you very much for giving us the honor of your personal presence. Thank you very much.
Okay, well, thank you so much, first of all, Professor Gebhardt, for organizing this wonderful event and for giving me, I think, the best introduction I've ever had. Very very interesting information about what is exactly right that we are trying to do as a press, and if anyone would like to know more, I'm sure there will be an opportunity afterwards to come up and we can talk about this further. I'm just going to say a few words about the book, really, just from a publisher's perspective. So we're here today to celebrate and discuss this miracle. I think there is a point in the preparation of every book where it does seem like it will be a miracle if it actually publishes. But this book certainly did, and I think it's a really, really fantastic volume, and I'm very much looking forward to hearing everyone discuss it today. I don't want to preempt those discussions too much, but I thought I would just pick out a few points that to me were interesting about the book. I think the book is actually a great many different things. It's a great introduction to the field. It's a fantastic student textbook. I think it's a very useful reference guide to practitioners working in the field. And also, as we've just heard, it's a good starting point for scholars to learn about the area and then ask these kinds of deeper questions that are explored at centers such as this one. But for me, what really struck me about this book is its focus on the whole of international economic law, or in the words of the author, this broad understanding of the field. And I think in this, the book is really breaking new ground. I think especially now, at a time when international lawyers are becoming increasingly specialized, and it's very tempting, for example, to see international investment law as an island that's sort of drifting far off the coast of general international law. It is important to have a book like this, which reminds us of the common principles and the common history of all of these different strands of international economic law. a WTO lawyer, an investment arbitrator, and an IMF legal advisor might all have different perceptions and different accents, but ultimately they do speak the same language. And I think the book is very important for reminding us of this. And then of equal importance, I think, is the book's focus on national as well as international law. It really highlights that the international economic order is ultimately implemented and enforced at the national level, which is perhaps not the most glamorous side of international economic law, the side that always gets the most interest, but ultimately one cannot understand and really appreciate the system without it. And then the second point that I just wanted to pick out very briefly is the fact that the book places human rights, environmental protection, and good government right at the heart of the international economic order. More work certainly needs to be done to align these principles with economic interests, but it seems to me that the book, and I think particularly as a teaching tool for a new generation of international economic lawyers, makes a very important start in this. Okay, so that just leaves me to really profoundly thank Professor Herdegen for all of his hard work and dedication on the book. It's been a huge personal pleasure for me to be able to work on it and to now see the result. And I very much look forward to all of the discussions here this afternoon. Thank you so much.
Don't be afraid, I don't come back all the time, but I just have to present the next speaker. It's Professor Dr. Dolzer. Most of you know him very well, but for those who are come from strange fields like cultural studies and so forth, it's possible that some of them don't know so exactly what you've done during the last 25 years, for example, where you had been in numerous arbitrations and as an expert and as an arbitrator acting in the world. You received your legal education at the University of Heidelberg and at Harvard Law School. From 1992 to 96, you were Director General in the Office of the Federal Chancellor in Bonn, by the way. So you taught all over the world, Chinese Academy of Social Sciences, Michigan Law School, Cornell Law School, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, Yale Law School. We learned why you didn't teach at Stanford some minutes ago, before, but that's another story. University of Paris, Sorbonne, Instituto de Empresa Business School, and the Southern Methodist University Dedman Law School. And of course, you were director of the Institute for International Law at the University of Bonn, as some of us will very well remind us. In August 2010, Professor Dolzer gave lectures at the Hague Academy of International Law on the evolution of oil and gas law from an international perspective. By the way, just to name only one example. Publications are really numerous, but interesting might be for some of you, together with Matthias Herdegen and Bernhard Vogel, Good Governance, Gute Regierungsführung im 21. Jahrhundert. That was a book that was very well received, and also together with Christoph Scheuer, Principles of International Investment Law. Oxford University Press in 2008, by the way. So no wonder that you will speak now and about a colleague's book and what he has done wrong and perhaps also right. Very welcome at our center, Professor Dolzer.
Thank you very much, Professor Gebhardt. It's always a great pleasure and honor to return to Bonn. I retired about 4 years ago. Bonn was the best place of my life in many respects. I would include the time at the Chancellor's office. I see here Mr. Duisberg. I think one of my first memories when I worked at the Foreign Office was to do some work together with Mr. Duisberg. This was on the most important German project of the century on reunification. And I'm very glad to see you. I'm also glad to see other old friends and colleagues. You will ask me now, after this kind introduction, what is the actual reason, what is the legitimacy why this gentleman is speaking here? An ideal laudator, I think, has to have two sides, a little bit complex now. One who is distanced enough to criticize, who knows the area, and who works in the same field. Fair enough, I'll try to comply with that. The second is to be a friend. There are what I call in our area of law people who are professional criticizers. They must be there, they are important. I don't like them particularly. Occasionally, I told someone recently, Max Einstein was criticized at one point by a colleague who did not have the same achievements, unfortunately. And Einstein was told, things are not as bright as you, as people presume. First of all, you were very bad in mathematics in school in Ulm. And you do not talk about that. Second, it took you a very long time to develop your theories. So things are not as clear as they should be. We do have such colleagues also in the law. I think they are useful, but I would not consider them to be ideal persons. Let me return to this issue right now, the issue of being in the same area as the person that is being honored. And to be distant from each other. I think by definitions we qualify for that. Our paths have crossed a number of times. Unfortunately, Matthias was not born or grown up in Swabia. This is something he can nothing do about. But it was at the fringes of Swabia. From Ulm to Karlsruhe, all of this is still acceptable. Then we met in the early 80s in the Max Planck Institute for Public International Law and Comparative Law in Heidelberg. We had the same teachers, and we had the same person with whom we wrote our habilitation, a great person. By the way, one strange thing that occurred to me the other day, in the Max Planck Institute where we grew up, there was no special emphasis whatsoever on international economic law. So we are a little bit deviating from our roots and origins. The focus was on the usual, I would say the usual things, war and peace, the legal status of Germany. The origin of the institute was connected to the First World War and the Treaty of Versailles. Human rights, the law of the sea, with a slight gap in international economic law. Maybe that's why we became interested in this. I don't know precisely. Then Matthias took a small detour going to Constance, which is acceptable, of course. Then I took a small detour going to the government for a while, which was acceptable to most colleagues, not all. Then we met again in 1996. Matthias was a well-established professor of international law in Bonn. I had earlier dealt with governmental issues, the intelligence services. When I came into the law school, there was a sign, no atomic rubbish at the law school. So, but the point is, at that time already, Matthias had an important contribution to make in terms of decision making, and decided together with the faculty that I should be teaching international economic law and constitutional law, which seems to be normal at first sight, but was not. And here I get back to my first point. Being a competitor, yes. We were and we are serious competitors by any standard. Matthias is one of the editors of chief of what used to be called Mount Zurich. I was for, I don't know, 15 or 20 years the editor of chief of the second commentary of the Bonner Commentar. That creates serious problems and frictions, of course, in everyday life. Except that Matthias used to contribute to the Bonner Commentar, which no one understood. But it was a good decision, by the way. Second, even more important, we had the same interest, we have the same interest in international economic law. So people would ask, why would you decide to bring someone to the same faculty on a very narrow subject matter where there are two of those? Usually it is the best thing to be the lone star, to be the only prince, so why do you bring in someone who would do the same thing? Matthias did it the opposite way. We never had any problem, we only had advantages of cooperation. And I would say after 1996 we happily lived together, to use the terms of the fairy tale. So I qualify as a serious competitor. It was just said that some, I think Mr. Gebhardt said it, some people are very narrow and try to focus and departmentalize and fragmentize the law. I, of course, belong to those and focus on one aspect of international economic law. I try to do a little bit more, but actually that's my focus. Matthias has the broad view. The book has the broad view. I will get to the books in a moment in this area. The point here is the book is the first of its kind in a major sense, and I will get to this in a moment, but let me talk first about the subject matter. Now it has been said that we don't want to talk about globalization anymore. Yes, this is absolutely correct. I was once in a commission of inquiry of the German parliament, I think for 4 years, and I think I had to listen to about 200 lectures, all of them interesting, more or less. Today, you don't hear the Sunday speeches on globalization. The World Bank does not use the word globalization any longer. It seems to me almost a kind of a parallel thing. Until 1997, the World Bank never used the word, the C word, corruption, was not to be mentioned. Today, I have almost a sense we have a G word, globalization. What happened, of course, is fairly simple. About 5, 6, 7 years ago, there were the annual meetings on globalization, with the consequence of major demonstrations and people only being able to fly in with a helicopter. So people decided it's not useful to speak about globalization. A major industrialist told me the other day, a German who is very globalized, his company perhaps the most globalized, he loves to speak about innovation and expansion. And he asked the speech writers not to use the word globalization. It only attracts negative comments by the press also. So globalization is out, so to speak, except that in reality it is in. Globalization, let me say a few words. When it started, I will be short on the history. We don't know when it started. Some people go back to the Roman times or to Alexander the Great. Others talk about 1492 and the New World. Others talk, and I think here it gets more serious, about the 1830s, 1840s, new trains, new means of communication, the English markets being saturated, and a first wave of globalization. What is not known generally is 1870 had a higher degree of globalization in economics than today in many areas. Then we get to 1914, the World War broke it up. Then the Second World War, same results. Then we had a period of reconstruction, which I think essentially lasted during the 50s and 60s. Then we had a political world that was not suitable to globalization during the Cold War, with a new start in 1989. Then we had the 2008 crisis, globalization going back a little bit. Today we are at a stage of globalization about 2008 in terms of the interwovenness of the economy, whatever that means. My point here is the following. If you look at the history of international economics since 1800 or 1840, however you decide, it is a constant movement toward globalization with interruptions for the First World War, the Second World War, the period of reconstruction. If you look at the period after 2008, the financial crisis, some people said the end of globalization. No. Globalization is continuing. From the economic point of view, the figures are fairly clear, the statistics. What do we have in terms of economic theory? I'm not always a friend of economic theory. We have a concept of liberalization, obviously. The Washington Consensus, 1989, a lawyer by background, actually an economist in practice, writes a small paper about the way in which Africa needs to develop. Africa had failed by any standard in the 80s, 90s, so what do we have to, what's the recipe for Africa? And he writes a relatively short paper about what used to become the Washington Consensus. Openness, open up your border, good governance, a number of other recipes, change your style. That became the Washington Consensus. The Washington Consensus for the World Bank, the IMF, and for the next door, the Department of Treasury, the United States, and then slowly coming to Europe. That Washington Consensus is no longer alive as such. It's modified. We have meanwhile found out that it needs to be the economic recipes need to be put in place. Social issues, environmental issues have not been emphasized enough in the Washington Consensus, but in principle, the liberalization approach of the Washington Consensus still is enough. So we have liberalization on the ground, we have liberalization to a large extent in terms of international economic theory. If you write today about international economic law, by definition, you write about a globalized economic world. Whether you want it or not, the issue is how do you approach this issue? And we will now try to look at this. Basically, I try to look at trade, finances, and the investment. As I say, in all of this area, globalization is very much alive. Essentially, what happened with globalization is the following. In the first, I'm now talking about the perspective of the Western state. The Western states first welcomed globalization. These are new markets for our companies. Second stage, things get a little bit more complex. All of a sudden, we find products of the what we used to call the third world in Europe, competing with our products. Not such a good thing. Third stage, all of a sudden we find out that contagion has becoming a little bit of a problem. Whenever there is something going wrong in China, it seems to affect us here. That's not a good thing, I guess. Next, all of a sudden we find out that together with the process of globalization, the larger centers of power, of political powers, have been shifting away also from the West. So you have a sense of, in the West right now, of globalization being a mixed bag. We're not quite sure whether we want it or not. For me, the biggest surprise, in a sense, came, and the biggest lesson came, with what you used to call the sovereign wealth funds. In general, of course, we were all open to foreign investment. And we expected everyone in the world to be open to foreign investment. This is good for the development of the economy. I still believe this is true. Then came about 2006, 2007, the sovereign wealth funds with enormous amounts of financial volumes investing in the West, Europe, the United States. We need to have some kind of commissions to look at this. We're not quite sure about this. So we had commissions, and we had some new laws about national security, and new laws to report, and new laws to screen. All of a sudden, the liberal basic attitude toward foreign investment was not changed, but it was somehow a little bit modified. Then came the financial crisis a year later. This was an unfortunate coincidence, time-wise. At the time of the financial crisis, all the concerns about sovereign wealth funds seemed to be forgotten. Please come, please invest, we need your capital. This was 2 years, only 2 years in between. When Germany changed its foreign economic law, this was 2 years thereafter. No more concerns about sovereign wealth funds. Today, we are in favor of sovereign wealth funds. Good enough, I think it is consistent with my general philosophy. But it shows you how volatile the political issues can be in this area. Let me briefly then look at trade, investment and finance. What is the pattern of regulation? How globalized are we in the first place? What is the legal response to economic globalization? Do we have a uniform pattern of response? Do we have diverse responses? What's the situation? In other words, do we have a global approach to globalization in terms from the legal viewpoint? I have to come back here to specialization, and the legal sphere is very specialized. I will get to Matthias's book in a moment. Essentially, we have three communities which meet each other, greet each other, but don't talk too much to each other. It's the trade community, including the academics. It's the investment community, and it's the financial community. We sort of are know each names, but we don't interact a lot. There are some good reasons for that. Trade is getting extremely specialized. If you want to know every detail about subsidies and dumping, that takes a lot of time, and that's only two fields. Investment is getting quite specialized. I have problems reading, I still try to read all the arbitral awards, but the piles are getting higher, and I may have to give up, even only for the purpose of investment. Financial laws. Someone just did a study, and he found that there have been 69 guidelines issued by the Basel committees since 2008. Now, this is only a very small part of financial law and the architecture. In other words, to follow all the three areas, plus services, plus intellectual property, has become a huge, perhaps an unmanageable task. But the point is, nevertheless, that I think academics and the students should be able to expect that essentially the course on international economic law gives them a good survey of all areas. I think that should be possible and must be possible. Notwithstanding that I like to teach one of these areas, but the three ones I think are necessary for a full survey. international trade. How globalized are we? It's in actual terms, it's very globalized on the ground. On the legal field, in terms of trade law, this is the most globalized area, legally speaking. Why? Because we have one set of international multilateral rules, we have a global organization, and we have a fairly well working, more or less, system of dispute settlement. Before 1994, we had a somewhat fragmented system, which is interesting to consider from a historical point of view. After the Second World War, there was an idea to have an international world organization for a while, to be called trade organization, but conceptually it was it included investment, it included some of the financial rules. This failed within 2-3 years, the reason being not that issues were too complex. The reason was that the United States Senate said no. This is too much. This seems to sacrifice too much of our sovereignty. This is getting, the executive branch is getting out of control in the United States. We need to hold this up. We don't need a World Trade Organization. We don't need a World Economic Organization. The result was that the president went ahead and simply saved that part of the project that did not require legislative approval by the Senate, and the outcome was the GATT, which on a relatively modest level survived until 1994. All of a sudden there was a discussion in the United States. The dispute settlement process is not good enough in the GATT, because every state, including the state affected, was able to veto any decision by the WTO. So the United States senators start to complain. Then they were asked, well, what would you what's your proposal? We can go back to a world with 192 legal orders, and we can go back to a world. You passed this Smoothly Act in 1932, which was one reason for the Second World War in some respect. If you want that, we can go back to that. Or the other option is, let's have a functioning dispute settlement approach. And the United States Senate, to the surprise of some of us, said, yes, let's have a functioning dispute settlement approach, and that was the beginning of the World Trade Organization. So there, we also incorporated services, actually different from trade, and we incorporated intellectual property, and we have a fairly good functioning system since 1994, except in 2002, the United States, my favorite country, promised to go ahead with a new round, with the Doha round. That was after 9/11. But meanwhile, the enthusiasm has been vanishing a little bit. These days, the Director General, a French, very competent French person, Pascal Lamy, is stepping down, totally frustrated, totally disappointed, mainly by the United States and Brazil. His successor will be Brazil, so we will see how this works. But in principle, the World Trade Organization works, is multilateralized. The current trend, of course, is not multilateralization, but regionalization, especially in Asia. We will now have a regional approach, presumably between Europe and the United States. I'm currently working on a plan between Europe and Russia. So we will have a patchwork of nice regional approaches, hopefully promoting and ultimately crystallizing a new multilateral order. I think this will not be in the near future. But essentially, in the trade area, we do have a multilateral approach in the past decade. Let me look at investment issues from the same point of view. No, multilateral agreement, we have about 3,050, I just checked this morning, bilateral treaties, and we have a few multilateral treaties with a fairly robust dispute settlement, however, completely different from the World Trade Organization. The World Trade Organization has state-to-state settlement. The investment regime has investor against states. Why don't we have a multilateral investment agreement? Originally it was proposed in the International Trade Organization 47, but then fell aside with the veto of the United States Senate. Then in the mid-90s someone said, now that the Berlin Wall has fallen and there will be more and more foreign investment, it's time for a multilateral investment agreement. This took 3 years and then failed, so to speak, overnight. What was the reason? The reason was very complex. There was no one reason. The United States had lost interest. The United States decided to prefer bilateral relations to a multilateral approach. I would say maybe not for good, but for understandable reasons. France said no multilateral agreement that includes the cultural sphere. We don't want American movies in Paris too much. The NGOs argued this was done in the dark. Before the OECD, that was not a transparent approach. Germany was unhappy, but not too unhappy about this. At that time, we had about 130 bilateral treaties. Do we really need a multilateral treaty where maybe the standards are not the same as in the German treaties? So yes, we were unhappy, but not too unhappy. 2000 to 2004, the second effort, the World Trade Organization had not addressed really investment issues, except that in 1994 they had included a small section on trade-related investment issues, a first step, tentative step of the World Trade Organization into investment issues, and in 2004, in 2000, a decision, yes, in principle, in the new round, we wish to include investment in trade. I was skeptical from the beginning. It failed in 2004. The whole thing was abandoned. Why? The United States was not especially fond, for the same reasons as in 1947. The developing states were not too fond either. The argument was more or less, we need to study this more. There needs to be enough policy space for us on the national level. I found that China was especially interesting example here. China had 120 bilateral treaties at the time, and yet argued that they don't know yet precisely what is to be regulated here. So this was a little bit of a complex approach by China. One of the undercurrents was in many parts of the world, perhaps the cross-cutting one, actually we don't want a world economic organization. That's too complex. We may not be able to handle this. If an error occurs in policy in this context, that's too difficult. And perhaps it's too much in terms of the sovereignty of the state at the moment. So this was abandoned. Everyone was sort of happy and unhappy in 2004. So far, no effort, and I don't see any effort at the moment. Occasionally, an academic is proposing that we need to, with these 3,000 treaties, that's very complicated, it's a patchwork, no one knows precisely what to find where. The jurisprudence is getting fragmented. We have a dispute settlement that works, yes, but we have a new panel for every case, that usually consisting of academics and lawyers. That means that there is no role of precedent. The jurisprudence, someone said the other day, is all over. In the major areas of the law, the jurisprudence is inconsistent in this area. It allows me to write books, but in principle, it's perhaps not such a good idea. Finance and architecture, the financial architecture, the third area here, essentially, of course, finances are and payments are only supposed to support trade and business. What we have here in terms of the, first of all, to speak about the developments on the ground. I always have difficulties with the zeros here. In June 2012, 800 trillion dollars were moved across borders. It defies my imagination. So, in terms of actual globalization, finances and payments are the most globalized. Mainly, of course, you would think for payments of trade services, investment. In reality, and here we have no good statistics, probably half of this figure comes from speculation. So we have a kind of a globalization here that is a special type of globalization. Of course, economists tell me that speculation in itself is nothing bad. I know that it can be bad, and the question is how do we separate the good from the bad sides? The world tried to deal with this. What we have since 1945, since the Bretton World institutions, we have the Monetary Fund, we have the World Bank, with fairly clear rules that changed occasionally, especially with the Monetary Fund. The most interesting part for me in terms of policy is what has been happening after the financial crisis in 2008. We all seem to agree that we need some type of new rules to avoid the developments of 2007, 2008. First question, what are those rules? Second, who determines them? Third, who administers them? The basic experience is simple. Even though we all complain that the 2008 global economic crisis was quite serious, the states were not willing to accept binding rules in many respects, with the exception of Europe. I'm not talking about Europe here. The states, as I said a moment ago, accepted 69 different codes and guidelines. I asked the other day someone in Washington, why are we so careful here? The Basel committees and others are all in favor of stricter rules. And the answer was the same as 1947. And the answer was the same as in 1995. The United States Senate will not pass any binding law as regards finances and payments. This is to, I asked, what is so special about payments and finance? Well, this is, the answer was, you are blind. Everything that has to do with money is too serious for binding commitment. Of course, you could say, the very strong dimension of speculation may make it more important to have regulations from the viewpoint at least of some economists to allow speculation is very important, so to have regulation would be counterproductive. In other words, the area where we have most of the density of globalization is strongest, we have least regulations. You could say, well, it has to do with the sensitivity of this economic sector. Whether this is ultimately a convincing reason or not, I'm not quite sure. To summarize my short survey of the legal status, we have a patchwork of international legal regulation for the globalized economy. We have a multilateral approach in principle for trade. We have a bilateral approach in principle for investment, and we have a kind of an informal approach, soft law, one of my favorite topics. Soft law, also in terms of dispute settlement for finances. In other words, we are far away from a uniform approach to globalization. Occasionally, I keep asking, do we want to? We have now 193 states. Can globalization survive with 193 legal orders that are applicable? That is an unfair question, because we do have, as I know, some legal rules. But I think in the long run, to have the global economy survive and the push for globalization, as I think it is, exists, survives with 193 legal orders with very broad competences in some area for domestic law, I think is a questionable proposition. I think we will, in the long run, we will see more international law, more global law. But we're not there yet. Let me turn briefly against this background to the book. Let me briefly see how international economic law has treated the subject matter. I can be relatively short, surprisingly short. We had the first major book by someone who had to leave Germany, Schwarzenberger, in the 50s, an English who was in England. Wrote a good book about the standards of international economic law, mainly focused on trade. Then we had a German book, not very well known, by a colleague called Erler from Göttingen, mid-50s, mainly focused on internationale Probleme des Wirtschaftsrechts, international problem of economic law, mainly focused on trade law. Relatively thin book, I think well written. Didn't get any attention, more or less. Then we have two major books, I would say, in the 80s. One is a good friend of mine with whom I taught trade law at one point, John Jackson. International Economic Law, very impressive, I don't know, I think 1,300 pages at least, mainly cases. I have highest respect for John. The book consists, 95% is on trade law, and he adds 50 pages on investment and finance law. So the title, International Economic Law, is a little bit misleading. It's not a book on international economic law. It's a book on one segment. We have someone from Germany, who is unfortunately no longer with us, Seidel Hohenfelden. He gave lectures in The Hague on international economic law. 90% were on investment law. That was his special area. I have highest respect for him, but that was not a book on international economic law as a whole. So we have a Spanish book of 2009, edited by two authors, which is a collection, a good collection of essays, but not more, not general treaties. What we do have so far, until this book has come out, was a French book, Dominique Caro-Juillard, two professors from the Sorbonne, both of them excellent, and their book on droit international économique is in the fifth edition, very well written. Caro has been a legal counsel of the International Monetary Fund, a specialist also on trade law. Juillard is the specialist on investment law. The trade law, I think, is too long for the students. I was told so by French students also. About 400 pages, about 200 pages in, almost 200 pages investment, about 100 pages on payments issues, surprisingly. Not more, given Caro's experience. There's one weakness of the book. The book is, in some respect, written against, as many French books are, it's a French book. It has very few citations in English. It has no citations, or very few, I should say very few, in German. It's written from a French perspective. I will get to this in a moment, not really in some respects. So we have all that was the situation before Matthias's book came out. Let me briefly compare Matthias's book then for a moment to the French book, which is the main competitor at the moment, except that it is in French.
There should be a translation into French.
Yes, I agree. I have just written, the fifth edition just came out, and I have just written to the first author, Jouillard, and I suggested to him that he should provide for a translation. The French book is different from Matthias's book in a number of important meanings that have already been touched upon here. First of all, the social, economic, political, legal context. Human rights. You will not find anything in Caro Jouillard. It's a strict French legal approach, a doctrinal approach, with no focus on the surrounding sciences. Environment. They don't even focus on the exception culturelle, which surprises me. You would think two French authors make sure that in their casebook the national heritage and the national tradition of France are reflected. Not the case. It's very French. The law, the law, the law. All of this human rights has a major role in Matthias's book at the beginning. He dealt with human rights. Matthias, of course, here you can see his background in German law is about individual rights. This is where he wrote his Habilitation. This is where he has made major contributions to the evolution of the law. I think this is reflected in the book on international economic law. The environment has a different connotation, a different role in Germany and in France. I said the other day, I have French relatives. The French don't have fairy tales and poems on the forests. We have a lot of fairy tales and poems on the forests. Local values, Matthias focuses also, as he likes to do, on rationality in the law. See the law as a construct that is rational. Of course, you could say from someone from France, with the French history of philosophy, would be well advised to do the same, not the case. The rule of law as a whole, I think for Caro Jouillard, the rule of law is the summary of their book. It's not a topic to be addressed independently. The last point, good governance. Matthias and myself have worked on good governance. Matthias continues to work. I don't at the moment pursue it to the same extent. A book just came out of a common student of mine today. Congratulations on good governance. She's sitting behind you. Very good book. So good governance, the institutional context, the role of institutions, is treated very well. I was for a while working for the World Bank. I have become a great admirer of those who focuses on institutions. The World Bank has first focused on projects. We found out focusing on projects is not good enough because they disappear after a certain time. Then it has focused on macroeconomics is important, but without institutions, macroeconomics won't function. Then it has tried something in between. Now, for the last 10, 15 years, it focuses, based on the work of two Nobel Prize winners, on institutions. I think institutions is very complex. To build institutions is terrible, but it's the only choice we have. So I think the focus in the book on good governance is most welcome, and it should elucidate the reader and the student. Here is an area, if you care about development issues, if you care about the rule of law, the institutions count. So this is also something different from Caro Jouillard and Matthias. What we have also here, what is also different and sets the book apart to a considerable extent, is the focus on sovereignty. Again, a little bit surprising. From a French person, you would have expected that sovereignty is a main topic. It's not in their book, but it's in the book of Matthias. Matthias has focused on the modern understanding of sovereignty beyond this book. So you find a chapter on the modern understanding of sovereignty. And of course, to a large extent, the tension between global regulation, a globalization of economic law, on the one hand, and the globe, the existing legal orders is an issue of sovereignty. So to focus on sovereignty and to indicate to the student where are the real issues with those 193 states who do not want to accept binding rules on banking supervision, I think that's very useful. The state is alive, we all know that. You focus on non-intervention. What I will find very interesting for the future is the role of the Third World as regards state sovereignty in the 70s. The Third World, especially Latin America, focused very heavily on state sovereignty. The famous Charter on Economic Rights and Duties of State and the New World Economic Order, all of this focused on state sovereignty. I'm not sure whether this will survive. I think the Third World will change its perspectives with the ongoing progress of globalization. I mentioned China a moment ago. China is now very interested in a stable international economic system. China is bringing cases of its own before the World Trade Organization. China now has most international treaties on investment in the Third World by far. And I think this will be the trend for the future, for the, in other words, a change for the developing world. If I would have to give advice to Matthias at the end, first of all, I think it's the best book on the market at the moment. I think I'm sorry to say it's better than, I'm a close friend of Jouyard and Caro. I think this book is better because it places the economic issues in a better context, in a wider context, which makes it easier to understand. As to the legal issues, we can all have our own approaches, but I think the wider context is very useful for the student. What type of advice do I have? Actually none, having criticized the critics of Einstein. Don't wait too long with the second edition. I have made a mistake waiting. If you wait too long with the second edition, it's too much work and it's too cumbersome. But Matthias has a habit of publishing rather speedily, so I have no doubt that this will work out. Second, tie together a little bit the pieces on globalization. I think globalization will remain the driving economic force. You have a lot of observations in various parts. I would try to pull them together. Third, consistent with what I said before, do not listen to critics. Ask them to write a better book. If they want to write a better book, that's fine. Fourth, be proud of your achievement. I think you wrote an excellent book. Thank you very much.
Erika De Wet received a BLE, an LLB, as well as an LLD from the University of the Free State, Bloemfontein in South Africa. She holds an LLM from Harvard University and completed her habilitation treatise, the Chapter 7 Powers of the United Nations Security Council at the University of Zurich in December 2002, was published in 2004. And then she is tenured professor of international constitutional law at the Amsterdam Center for International Law. If globalization does not exist, global actors do exist, and you're one of them, in any case, that's for sure. Since January 2011, you're professor of international law and co-director of the Institute for International and Comparative Law in Africa at the University of Pretoria. And she also lectures in international law at the University of Zurich and the University of Bonn. That's why she is just a colleague of ours, and we're very proud of that, of course. So the publications, what could be interesting for you? Europeanization of public international law, it's an interesting topic. Also perhaps the hierarchy in international law, what it is about, what is hierarchy? It is the role, it is about the role of the and the place of human rights in this context. And how conflicting normative orders are to be dealt with and are to be treated, and how what kind of solutions we have to those conflicting, overlapping, and sometimes really conflicting orders is a big issue in international law and in the complicated situation that you reminded us with the 193 states with their specific, very specific legal orders and different legal cultures that are behind. That what makes it sometimes even worse and more complicated. However, it works in a way and in a web of overlapping institutional contexts and networks that make it possible that the world is not as chaotic and anomic as one could expect it to be. So the contribution that the experience of Southern African development community might bring into the debate will be presented by Erika de Wet, and you're very, very welcome at our center. And we hope to continue the discussions with you and the interaction with your several institutions that are behind that wonderful person you are. Come on, that's your turn.
Professor Gebhardt, thank you very much for those warm words of welcome. It is a great pleasure and honor for me to be here today in this wonderful setting here in Bonn. And it is a great honor for me also to participate in this book presentation by Professor Herdegen. My ties with Professor Herdegen does not go as far back as those with of Professor Dolzer, but very early on during my stay in Germany, when I came to Germany for the first time in 1991, our paths crossed at the Max Planck Institute at the time. And one of the many interests of Professor Herdegen is, of course, also comparative constitutional law, and he was also very interested in the constitutional change that was going on in South Africa at the time. And we have, on an on and off basis, remained in touch during the years, and since 2010, I am a visiting lecturer at the University of Bonn at the Faculty of Law, and I'm really very grateful and happy that Professor Herdegen took the initiative at the time to invite me to become involved at the Faculty of Bonn. And I enjoy coming here, and it is a great privilege today for me to share a few thoughts with you on the Southern African development community, which is also mentioned in Professor Herdegen's book. And as Professor Dolzer has mentioned, one of the many good aspects of the book is the fact that it links different, it brings together different fields of economic law, but it also makes the links to other subcategories of public international law. Not only, you have already mentioned that within the field of international economic law as a major field, it is difficult to be in control of all the different aspects because it's so huge and so specialized. But that is an even bigger problem if one tries to make the connections with other areas, sub-areas of public international law, like the environment, like human rights. But Professor Herdegen's book does touch on these issues in a quite a fundamental way and exposes the way that these different subcategories interact with one another, and somehow in a way that one wouldn't expect. Now, the Southern African development community is an economic, a regional economic community aimed at regional development and integration. And We have several of these on the African continent. There's the African Union, and then it's a huge continent with different dynamics in different parts. And then in the different regions and sub-regions, there are these sub-regional economic communities. Some better developed than others. Now, the Southern African Development Community initially started out as the Southern African Development Coordination Conference during the eras of apartheid in the 80s and until the early 1990s. And the frontline states, the states around South Africa, came together in an attempt to try and be economically more independent from South Africa. But when things started to change, also under the influence of what was happening, especially in Europe and the success of European integration, other regions to some extent tried to copy these models in their regions in order to further regional economic integration. And as South Africa was also integrated into the fold and being a very important economic actor in the region, there was a hope that this new regional economic community would become an important vehicle for development in the area. Now, what has happened is that in Western Africa, and also in Southern Africa, somehow these what was intended to be economic communities aimed at economic development, to some extent became hijacked, at the lack of a better word, by the human rights community. One important reason being that these economic communities also had their own tribunals. The statutes, the treaty provided for the creation of a tribunal to which also individuals under circumstances had access. Now, as it so happened, it also happened in Western Africa with more success than in Southern Africa, when individuals were unable to enforce certain basic human rights within their own domestic systems. Of course, under the influence of lawyers and NGOs, they considered to what extent they could utilize the SADC tribunal, the tribunal of this economic community, to enforce certain human rights, with rights that were connected also to certain economic developments, and I'll come back to that in a second. So what one literally had here one day was, and I asked 2 weeks ago my friends at Foreign Affairs who were involved in the negotiation of the SADC treaty. Well, at the time when you negotiated this in the mid-1990s, as part of the goals and principles of the community, principles such as human rights, democracy, rule of law were articulated. They are there. They are textual hooks on which one can pin arguments on human rights in this treaty. But at the time, did you ever reflect that one day some active NGO may actually interpret this commitment or this goal to pursue human rights or to pursue economic development in accordance with human rights and the rule of law, would actually interpret this as endowing individuals with rights or recognizing human rights also at the level of the tribunal? And he said, of course not. You know, we didn't. That it just sounded so good at the time. You know, think back. This was the mid-1990s. Mandela was president. South Africa was had a constitutional court. We all thought things were beginning to work. Of course, it sounded so good to commit everyone to human rights. Who was going to argue? Not even Robert Mugabe at the time, who also at the time was not as extreme as he became shortly afterwards. So I think already, and also to link this to the theme of law and culture, there is the approach to law in certain parts of the developing world is different than in Europe. There's not necessarily reflection at the time that these treaties are drafted as what are we trying to achieve with this, what these are living instruments, they will get a life of their own, they will have all kinds of implications. Are we ready to abide by these rules which we are so eagerly creating? And unfortunately, the commitment to the rule of law, Rechtsstaatlichkeit, as we would instinctively appreciate it in continental Europe, is not necessarily the same. And when the law starts to bite, states tend to gang together and try to wiggle their way around this. And this is in fact what also happened in the case of the SADC tribunal. Now, the tribunal, like I said, it was created in the treaty, and then there were additional protocols, separate treaties. Several of these protocols elaborated on various issues, on various topics: trade, finances, environmental protection, privileges and immunities of international officials. Certain basic principles which were articulated in the main SADC treaty were then developed and further concretized in additional protocols. One of them was the protocol on the tribunal, which created an elaborate tribunal with judges and with an extensive jurisdiction also to interpret and apply the treaty and disputes pertaining to the treaty. And also very importantly, and at the moment a huge problem, is that civil servants, people employed by the SADC organization, actually if they had an employment dispute, the tribunal was the sole institution that could receive those kind of claims. It was due process for people who were fired and who faced individual employment disputes. So the tribunal had quite an ambitious jurisdiction in accordance with its protocol. It was also supposed to be a major vehicle for receiving interstate disputes, but the long and short of that is, until this day, that aspect of the tribunal's work was a dead letter. It was officially, in 2001, it was endorsed legally, but it actually was up and running by 2005 with a building in Windhoek in Namibia and judges and all the rest of it. And it had a very short-lived life until 2010, when it was suspended illegally without following any proper procedure, because by that time there were several cases pending. The tribunal had decided 19 decisions that I can get hold of. I cannot promise that I didn't miss any decision, because it's not, court decisions and documents in Southern Africa are not published and made accessible as diligently as one would hope for. But 11 of those 19 decisions concern Zimbabwe. And in particular, the so-called land grabbing cases. There was the Campbell case, to which I will come back in a minute. And actually, 8 of those 11 cases concerned the Campbell case in one form or another. Additional parties trying to join the case, trying to block the case, contempt of court claims on by some of the parties, and so forth. So that was the major case that also stirred, that actually made it exposed to governments that they have underestimated the link between economic law and human rights, and they never thought through that a tribunal which they saw as a vehicle for dealing with common interstate trade disputes or disputes between investors and so on, that this would actually come back to bite the state on basic issues of human rights. The other cases mainly concerned disputes by civil servants within the secretariat of SADC who had employment disputes with SADC and approached the tribunal. Some of them had success and had were entitled to compensation or to reinstatement, and others had less success. But what was decisive here was the Campbell case. And Mr. Campbell, well, that is, there were actually 78 other farmers, it was a collective action, who were victims of the land grabbing practices of Robert Mugabe in Zimbabwe. And the Zimbabwean constitution was changed in a way that allowed for expropriation on a massive scale without compensation, and also without any access to a court of law to dispute this. And so, in a quite sensational, the actors who were, it was quite an interesting combination of people who got together, who are not usually politically friends, but who actually got together and launched a case at the SADC tribunal. Not on the basis of expropriation as such, because the right to property is not guaranteed in the SADC treaty, but the principle of non-discrimination is, and the principle of respect for the rule of law and democracy in a kind of a broad sense are actually guaranteed in the SADC treaty. And those were the hooks on which these claimants pinned their case. Now, I think strategically a very big mistake that they made looking back, there were several now that one can discuss with a vision of hindsight. But this also, you know, the land issue in Southern Africa is a very sensitive issue. The whole colonial practice and the domination is something that is very sensitive and drastically needs attention. There's no way around that. Therefore, this type of case by a former colonial farmer with huge, huge land and who fought in the Rhodesian War on the wrong side of the war kind of awakens all kinds of emotions. Perhaps had the litigators not only litigated on behalf of Mr. Campbell and all the white rich farmers, but also on the behalf of the thousands of farm workers who were also evicted, lost their rights to housing, their right to an income, also had no access to any court of law to dispute these incidents, I think perhaps the character that it would have given a different flavor to the case as a whole. It's not only the property rights of the rich farmers who were at stake, but the security of tenure of thousands of employees who were destitute and much worse off in a way than several of the farmers. But nobody took notice, or I don't understand, and I've had this discussion with some Zimbabwean colleagues, why nobody thought just strategically of including them in this claim. And to make a long story short, and initially for the rule of law, I think this was a victory in Southern Africa that 14 of the 15 black judges on the tribunal found in favor of the plaintiffs and decided that this was discriminatory because of the manner, not only the fact that virtually all of the victims were white. Of course, most of them would be white because most of the farmers were white at the time, so that's obvious, but there was no compensation, and also the expropriated land wasn't given to people who were destitute or in need. They were given to the party friends of Robert Mugabe. So the procedure, the way, the patterns of behavior of the Mugabe government underscored a pattern of victimization and discrimination. But there are problems with the legal reasoning. The court also just very sweepingly decided that it's undisputed that a basic element of the rule of law is that one should have access to a court to claim one's case. Now, make one's case. Now, instinctively, I would agree, but I would have expected a bit more flesh in the whole reasoning. Now, Zimbabwe actually had, I think, one very good point, which they didn't argue very well, but they argued well that these references to human rights and democracy and non-discrimination in the statute were not guaranteeing individually enforceable rights that one could claim as an individual before a court, because they were too vague. That's not where I thought that the problem lied. The court, I think, correctly referred to what we call in international law the principle of systemic integration, that the core content of those human rights can be distilled from other treaties which, in this case, Zimbabwe had ratified and were bound by in any case. So the SADC treaty is what is being applied here, but its content is being informed by other norms of international law to which the country is bound. And from that, one can clearly distill what non-discrimination and the like means. And that I don't think, was my main concern with this judgment. But were these principles ever intended to be individual rights, or were they just goals that the states set for themselves? They were not framed as rights. If one look at how individual rights in human rights treaties are framed, they are not framed in the way that these goals were articulated. Now, of course, this treaty is a living instrument. And one could make the argument that over time and through the behavior of the states and so forth, it's fair to conclude that they were intended to function as enforceable rights within this context. But I actually do think there is an issue here, and that it is not necessarily as clear-cut as one may think at first sight. Needless to say, the Mugabe government, as was to be expected, rejected the decision. And this is where I find also legally, and one can reflect, and I'll leave that to the audience, what does that say about legal culture in the region? I think becomes rather interesting. The case, according to Article 32 of the tribunal's statute, any decision is binding on the parties and has to be enforced in the states concerned. Now, that is very broadly articulated. It can be interpreted as only those states which were affected in the dispute, but you can also interpret it as all the member states, because they are all concerned by this. And it explicitly provides that enforcement is to occur in accordance with the rules of civil procedure for the registration and enforcement of foreign judgments. So this protocol that is an instrument of public international law explicitly provides that a classic instrument of private international law is used to enforce decisions of the tribunal. Now, what is interesting, and I think once again, because at the time when all of this was drafted, what was the type of conflicts and disputes that countries had envisioned? They had not envisioned a human rights claim against a state. They envisioned trade disputes, investment disputes between either private parties or perhaps a private party, a cross-border private party, somebody in South Africa, somebody in Botswana, or sometimes the government may have been involved or not, but classic economic disputes, not an enforcing a judgment so that assets can be taken hold of in order to give effect to a judgment. That is the kind of thing that they had in mind. So Zimbabwe then started campaigning against the decision. It claimed that the decision was illegal. It even claimed that this tribunal was created illegally, and it made very contorted and confused legal arguments. Politically, however, it was very effective. It argued behind the scenes, well, you know, if they can do this to us on non-discrimination and on land grabbing, Botswana has the death penalty. The next thing you'll know, they'll force you to abolish the death penalty, which I would argue is not true, because Botswana hasn't, there's no general prohibition of the death penalty under international law unless states have ratified specific treaties to that effect. Botswana hasn't. But of course, immediately it stirs that fear. Malawi, at the time, immensely homophobic. They now have a different president, but you know, terrified that the next thing, the tribunal will oblige them to legalize and decriminalize homosexuality. Meanwhile, their president has, even without the tribunal. But so there was politically, it was easy for Zimbabwe to generate a certain fear about how this Frankenstein will now impose on their sovereignty, which they were still very jealous about. Very interestingly is that when the decision was registered, or an attempted registration of this decision was undertaken in Zimbabwe, the Zimbabwean High Court, the judge, I actually thought, did a very good job under the circumstances. He openly acknowledged that his own government's argument about the illegality of the tribunal, that it wasn't established according to the correct procedure, was a distorted argument. He systematically went through the treaty itself and why that wasn't true. It admonished its own government for the fact that for a long time after the tribunal was created, Zimbabwe supported it. It financed it. It even had a judge on the tribunal. So it cannot then, after having endorsed the tribunal for several years, suddenly wake up one morning and suggest that it's all been illegal and it's all been one big mistake. Having said that, it then emphasized, the judge then said, nonetheless, we cannot enforce this decision in Zimbabwe. And yeah, I disagree with what he did, although I can understand politically, but the international law part, he did very accurately. He referred to Article 32 of the protocol of the tribunal that that indicates that decisions from the tribunal have to be treated like decisions from a foreign state, foreign judgments. Now, inherent to that is the public policy exception, which allows for different cultural perceptions as well. And this is unusual in international law to have this kind of construction, because usually in international law, you can't make that argument that our domestic law is opposed to the international rule that is binding on us. The same applies to a binding international decision. A domestic court has to find a way to accommodate it. But now, because of this reference to treating the tribunal's decisions as foreign judgments, there is a little back door open through the public policy exception. Personally, I would have preferred had the judge argued domestic public policy itself requires it of overriding importance to give effect to the international decision. Politically, that just was no go. And Judge Patel then indicated that this public policy requires the opposite, because the Zimbabwean constitution explicitly requires expropriation without compensation and so forth, and therefore there was nothing he could do. That wasn't the end of the story, because then the litigants came to South Africa. And also, like I've mentioned, Article 32 indicates that this decision is enforceable in the states concerned. So, South Africa is a state concerned. We're a member state. Zimbabwe underestimated the impact of what was happening here entirely, because the case was then registered like this in the Pretoria, in the Gauteng North High Court, also because Zimbabwe didn't oppose. They didn't turn up. And the lawyer was very smart in asking for a monetary judgment. What he wanted to enforce was money. These people needed to be compensated. In order to do that, you need to register the decision and in accordance with South African law and as required by the protocol of the tribunal. That freed the way of taking hold of Zimbabwean assets in South Africa, as long as it's not assets protected by immunity. Like the embassies and assets protected by immunity cannot be seized. But what about the rest? And this is then when Zimbabwe started to become rather edgy about the whole thing, because the next thing, several properties in Cape Town were seized. And that was then opposed by Zimbabwe. And the judge then was quite lenient on them when that came before another high court in Johannesburg, and indicated that it was clear that in one instance the property was used for commercial purposes, that could be seized. But in two other instances, it used to be consular property, so they'll give Zimbabwe, now they were vacant, but they'll give the country the benefit of the doubt. Colleagues at Foreign Affairs actually indicated that the South African government didn't regard the consular property as protected. It doesn't have the same status as an embassy, and that it could have been seized as well, and that they had hoped that the judge would be harsher. But Zimbabwe has now appealed. The case is currently, as we speak, before the South African Constitutional Court. However, the South African Supreme Court of Appeal, which is just below the Constitutional Court, was relied heavily on the decision of its Zimbabwean colleague, the Gramara case, in first of all reinforcing the tribunal was legal, the decision was binding. Zimbabwe couldn't claim immunity at this very late stage from any proceedings in South Africa, also because of Article 32 of the Statute of the SADC Tribunal, which explicitly provides for enforcement in member states. So by ratifying that protocol, Zimbabwe had given up, waived any right to immunity of being protected from this kind of seizure of property. I have no sympathy with the Zimbabwean government, but once again, I think, and if one had more time, one could could ask oneself, yes, this all sounds very well, but was this really the intention of Article 32? Was Article 32 intended for this type of claim? Should this type of claim ever have been brought before the tribunal to begin with and then be enforced in the member states? Had I been the victim, I would have done exactly the same. But I just think conceptually and dogmatically, one has to ask, think through what has happened here. The long and the short of the story was that now the South African courts are digging their heels in, and they're giving effect to this decision that was given down by the SADC tribunal, even though the tribunal has been suspended. It has been suspended illegally, the correct procedures were not followed, but it was literally a matter of governments deciding they're not going to fund it anymore, and they sent the judges packing. There's a huge problem. I will not go into, if there are questions, we can go into that during question time. There are huge problems now with the structure. What does this leave us with? Where are we now? Now, the tribunal, this means that the human rights cases that were pending before the tribunal are now languishing. They're hanging there and they're not going anywhere. I've mentioned various additional protocols, treaties have been added to this whole SADC system. Most of those treaties indicates that if there is a dispute, the tribunal has to deal with it. It has the jurisdiction to apply its mind and resolve the dispute. So those disputes cannot be resolved. There are two exceptions, and there are like 30-something protocols. Two exceptions that I could find. The one was the protocol on trade, which at the first level stage make provision for panels like you have at the WTO, interstate disputes with panels of arbitrators appointed. So at that level you could still function. Until now that protocol has been a dead letter, nobody has used it, but if it were to function better, at that level it could. Then there's a very interesting development, and I overlooked this, there's the protocol on finance, the FIP. Financing and Investment Protocol, which is a little obscure instrument which nobody has taken much notice of, but it actually provides for arbitration. And it has a default, procedure. If the parties cannot agree on how to deal with the arbitration, then the Unstrut rules would apply. Now what has happened is that private investors who sued Lesotho before the SADC tribunal. Now obviously this case is now also hanging there because the tribunal has been suspended. So they've gone back and looked, what other options do we have? They found the FIP, the finance protocol, and there is, they found this avenue of arbitration, and they are now claiming that Lesotho, by colluding with other states to suspend the tribunal, had denied them access to justice and undermine their access to the tribunal in an unlawful way. And as a result, they are now claiming their right to arbitration under this protocol. So you see the spillover effect of the suspension of the tribunal. It's not an issue that's going away. Now, on the good side, I must say, this whole case and the series of events shows that something about the legal culture in Southern Africa, that countries tend to jump onto things that have worked in Europe because they think it will bring them funding, they think it will bring them prestige. They don't think through what they're getting into, sometimes because of lack of capacity, but sometimes simply because they don't really care about the law. They just think this will benefit us in some way economically, so just let's go for it. It also exposes that countries who do not, it doesn't help to shift a problem from the domestic to the regional. If a country doesn't respect the rule of law domestically, it's not going to solve anything to create a regional organization, because ultimately that decisions have to be brought home and implemented back home. And if the countries are not willing to do that, it's not going to work. At the same time, we have in the region some courts that work. In South Africa, we have problems, but the court function system as a whole is still limping along. We're a very litigious nation. We watch a lot of American television, and we have a very strong civil society, and very vibrant NGOs who are like little fox terrier dogs going after all the big Rottweilers, and they are nipping, they keep on nipping at the heels and finding ways to keep the tribunal alive. We will see whether it means also that people haven't given up in believing in the law. They haven't entirely given up in believing the law is so good to individuals, that it can protect individuals. And in developing countries, this is not something to be taken for granted. I can assure you, in large parts of Africa, there is a huge distrust in the law, in formal law as an institution, that it protects the interests of ordinary people. But in Southern Africa, I don't think it's that bad yet. I do think that there still is the dynamics, the rather contradictory dynamic, shows that somehow we're on the knife's edge and we just don't know which side it will go to. One final comment, and I will stop at that. And there may be questions. Another issue which is now languishing, all these civil servants who are being fired and having employment disputes have nowhere to go. Now, international lawyers will know the Wait and Kennedy jurisprudence of the European Court of Human Rights, and the one area where European domestic courts have been lifting immunity of international organizations have exactly been in this area, where they do not provide equivalent protection internally for employees. It's happened in Belgium, it's happened in France with obscure international organizations which have not provided judicial protection for international civil servants. And as a matter of state responsibility, these states which host these organizations were then obliged to provide the equivalent of or some kind of legal protection before their own domestic courts. My point being, it's only a matter of time before some disgruntled SADC employee ends up before the Botswana High Court, where the SADC Secretariat has its basis. Also in South Africa, I don't know whether our courts will have jurisdiction according to our domestic jurisdictional rules, but basically hold the state, the member state, responsible for the fact that it is member of an international organization which does not provide judicial protection for its employees. And it will rely on the arguments of Wait and Kennedy and similar cases in Europe where immunity was lifted as a result. Now, it will have to be an argument along the lines of analogy, because of course the African states are not a party to the European Convention, but they are to the International Covenant on Civil Political Rights and the African Charter. So one could make a similar argument. I don't think that this is a lasting solution. It places these domestic courts in a huge position of tension with their governments and with SADC. I'm not sure that that is necessarily in the long run a good thing. You also have the risk of diverging jurisprudence. Different courts in different member states, some lifting immunity, some not. That is also not necessarily a good thing, but at least it keeps on nipping at the heels of these countries and expose to them that their citizens are not necessarily content with the way that things are going. I think I will stop at that, because I've spoken for more than half an hour. There may be some questions. And just as a last word, this incident and this process that we involve in now within the Southern African development community exposes the relevance of Professor Herdegen's book and the link that he makes between international economic law and the other sub-areas of law, such as human rights, how immensely intertwined these issues are. Also, expropriation, compensation, the impact on human beings, the economic aspect, the human rights aspect, and then just the justice aspect. And that even that when we deal with these different issues, how important it is to keep in mind that one is not only dealing with one sub-area of law, but that it affects, that it has a ripple effect, and that one must remain open for those cross-cutting links. Thank you very much.
So I have the enormous pleasure to announce and to welcome Mr. Pravin H. Parekh, who came from very far away, from India, from Delhi. So for most of us, it comes closer and closer because Indian scholars are playing more and more a central role in our debates. Historians, sociologists, jurists, and others. Where does it come from that India is doing this contribution to knowledge society today? It would be a long debate to discuss this question. So I must be much more humble in order just to present you, and you will explain by doing it afterwards why we have so much to learn from you in India. You are a senior advocate at the Supreme Court of India, situated at Delhi. Mr. Parekh studied at Elphinstone College. Here there is a note that it is in Bombay. I am speaking more politically correct of Mumbai, of course, and at Government Law College there. Further, he passed a PIL, Program of Instruction for Lawyers, at Harvard University. He chambered with Mr. Yoshi, Senior Counsel for the Income Tax Department at Mumbai, and there are a lot of stations from Mumbai going to Delhi, where he chambered with Mr. Gokhale, Senior Advocate, former Union Minister of Law and Justice of India, and a very important function. And he has founded and headed Parekh & Co., one of the premier law firms in India. If you go to the internet and you put in your name, you will find this wonderful law firm, where one day when I have really a difficult case in India, I might knock at your door. With one of the largest filing in the Supreme Court for the last three decades. In 2011, he was awarded the Padma Shri title by the President of India, an extraordinary honor, not only in this country. He also is, inter alia, former president of the Supreme Court Bar Association, president of the Confederation of Indian Bar, and organizing secretary of the International Law Association, the regional branch of India. I want also to mention one thing, and this might also lead to the topic where you will deal with justice, and that were the last phrases of the former contribution that we listened to. That is the question of justice and the human rights implications. So Mr. Parekh is editor of the Human Rights Yearbook, and this is also a possibility to be informed about your engagement in the question and in the pursuit of justice, rights, and perhaps also obligations. We'll see in your and during your contribution. Thank you very much for having come over to Bonn and to participate in the eulogies we are doing for the book of Matthias Herdegen. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you very much, Professor Gephardt. In fact, you have put me and on the same level as the audience by giving fresh air to me and giving fresh air to the audience. Professor Matthias, my very, very dear friend, Dr. Erika, Mrs. Merrill, Rudolf, and distinguished guests. Need for a consistent administration of justice in domestic and international law. What is justice? Justice is the fulfillment of rational expectation. Everyone has some expectation from law, from justice. Why do you have law? Law is meant to do justice. Justice to all people. And since it is a universal fact that justice really is fulfillment of expectation, whether it's domestic justice or international justice, it has to be same. periphery, there may be some differences about what justice should be or can be. In substance, there cannot be any difference. In fact, justice, really, without justice, we become animals, and therefore justice is what is required. In fact, someone, the jurist, has defined justice that it is the fulfillment of rational expectations. Aristotle said, at his best, man is the noblest of all animals. Separated from law and justice, he is the worst. Now, basic law, Germany, the constitution is called basic law. India has a written constitution. Large number of countries have written constitution. What does the constitution provide? It wants equality. It wants freedom. It wants everyone to have liberty, various liberties, rule of law, and not rule of man. Distributive justice, you cannot ignore your poor and less fortunate citizens of a country, and you cannot say that we laissez-faire is gone. You can't say that I'm the highest, richest man and I will do what I like. No, you will not do it. And therefore, when there is distributive justice, will mean that he will provide for those who are needy, those who are requiring things, etc. And when you fail into distributive justice, then corrective justice comes into play and say, this is not on. In fact, a German jurist in 1888, Ernest Zittelmann, thought of global law, Weltrecht, Germany as he called it, that there should be a global law. Why should I have an Indian law and German law and British law and so on and so forth? Why can't there be one law which will apply to all the countries? It was a very great and a good dream of him, because the object is the same. Why do we have so many different laws in different countries? Of course, the sovereignty, that I am the boss in my country and you are the boss in your country, may interfere with about your trying to achieve a global law. It has not succeeded. United Nations has succeeded on peripheral things. You have a TRIPS which deals with the laws relating to patent. There are various, some of these, most of them are either multilateral treaties or bilateral treaties, and therefore it will bind you and your citizens because your government has signed it. But that is hardly any common law or a global law, you can call it. But this is, in fact, Roscoe Pound in 1906 said that a superficial, to show that all legal systems among all people have given rise to the same complaints. And therefore, just as your expectation from justice is the same, your complaints against not rendering justice is also universally same. In fact, in administration of justice, you need consistency. And because it is consistency is required, because law should be predictable. A person should know in advance that what can I do, what can I not do. And that is why the consistency of law is very, very important. And since consistency of a domestic law is important, so is the consistency of international law. Law secures against the errors of individual judgment. Consistency also provides against the improper motives on the part of those who administer justice. Law also provides the standards in which the ethical ideas of the community are formulated, and law gives the benefit of all experience of its predecessors and prevents sacrifice of ultimate interest. The globalization about which our friend talked, it is to some extent a reality now. Man is now much more shifting from a country to country, either physically or even if he is not there physically, his capital is moving from country to country. And therefore, the globalization is to some extent a reality. And therefore, again, the question of the international law comes in, that when A goes from a particular country to country B, what is he supposed to do? What laws will apply to him? In fact, recently our Indian Supreme Court has dealt with a judgment of Novartis case, where multinational company wanted to claim, in fact, it was going to lose his patent since it was coming to an end, and he said that this is my innovation, and the Supreme Court applied the international standard by saying that is it substantive innovation or is it a trivial innovation? If you just claim the name of the medicine and say this is my innovation, it's not made by you. What your medicine was made by is a well-known product available to anyone, and for then you to claim that give me. Now what happened? It was a drug which is very very useful for the cancer patients. A disease which was few decades back was thought to be incurable is now curable. And if you allow a case like this, then you are preventing the poor patients in different countries the use of that medicine, because the price of that medicine goes up 100 times or 200 times higher than what the cost is to them. So this again are social, but I mean legally, the according to me, the judgment is perfectly correct, because the court found as a matter of fact that this was trivial and not substantial innovation. Now the world has also become a global village for another reason, and therefore again uniform laws, the cyber crimes, the large number of intellectual property, confiscating online bank accounts, creating and disturbing viruses on other computers, posting confidential business information on the internet and disrupting a country's critical national infrastructures are the most extensively used forms of cyber crimes, apart from the well-known ones of illegal access, cyber piracy, trademarks violation, identity theft, cyber terrorism, cyber laundering, etc., and certain cyber crimes committed by the nation against other nation also. That's all is a reality, and that again brings us closer to why you have international law which should be consistent with the domestic law or the local law as it is known. Now, what is the role of law and how the law is made and what is the purpose of the law or justice? And that again, as I said, is universal, peripheral, there may be. One, of course, the two objects of every law for a domestic, any country, is one to defend its sovereignty from the foreign aggression. That, of course, no doubt that is the function of a state. The other one is administration of justice. You give civil justice, criminal justice, taxation, and various other justice. So these two are definitely the compulsory functions of any state. But now it's no longer possible to say that the state has not to render welfare activities. And the state cannot be a person who will not bother whether what is happening on various fronts to the poor of their citizens. They would need education. I mean, in fact, United Nations has come out with the 8-point frameworks, poverty and hunger eradication. I mean, on one side you have large number of people who die of hunger, children who die of malnutrition. That's happening, and of course, it's possible to say that it's not happening in my country; it's happening in someone else's country. But then, humanity is one, and therefore this is happening in large number of countries. India, of course, has improved a lot, and we are now reasonably well off. But there are countries where people die of hunger, and what do we do? What does the international law does, or what's the domestic law? Gender equality, in fact, the women empowerment in India, a very important judgment was given by Supreme Court. It is known as Visakha judgment. The women at workplace suffered from sexual harassment by the employers or the superior bosses under whom the lady is working. And that's a reality. It happens in perhaps all over the world. But that's a favor is sought from your subordinate women employee. A sexual favor, if you want promotion, if you want something or the other. I mean, I won't say it happens every day and everywhere, but this is something which it does happen. And the Supreme, there is no law in India on this as to how do you deal with such a crime committed against a woman. And generally a woman is reluctant to complain when some such thing happens. You know, it's very difficult for her to complain, much less going to police or complaining or filing a suit, etc. Even complaining to the higher bosses or informing the family members also is a little bit of problem for a lady to come out with this. The Supreme Court of India came out with a judgment in which it says that every employer who employs more than 20 women will come out with a committee, internal committee, in-house committee, and a lady can complain, and that internal committee will ensure and find out whether this allegation is correct. Of course, in a 100 out of one may be a false complaint, but normally a lady is not likely to make such a complaint, you know, which is false. So, and to provide relief to her. Now, this is to be done not only by the government corporations and companies, but even private corporations. Now, in India, our Supreme Court has developed something called public interest litigation, which is an excellent arm of Supreme Court. Number one, public interest litigation is not meant for A versus B. It is not a case of A saying that injustice is done to him by B, and therefore two of them fight and go to normal courts, etc. Public interest litigation is meant for the class action. Now, therefore, one of the issues, this case was decided under the public interest litigation. Now, there is a environment, all countries want to protect, have laws to protect environment, all sorts of pollutions will take place. You pollute the air, you pollute the water, rivers are polluted, that happens. And therefore, the Supreme Court at times comes out and takes charge under a public interest litigation. Now, in one of the cases, one Mr. Vinit Kumar Mathur, wrote a postcard to the Chief Justice of India saying that such and such river, which passes through large number of different states, is totally polluted and nobody is taking any action because those who are supposed to control the pollution are bribed by those who are polluting, and therefore the untreated pollutants get into the river. So what do I do? The Supreme Court appointed me as an amicus curiae, because that man, poor man, just wrote a postcard. He's not going to come either to spend money on lawyers or to come all the way to Delhi. Delhi, in fact, is not a central of India. It's in a northern part of India. So southern states people find it extremely difficult even to travel. We have no benches of Supreme Court. It's all in Delhi. So Supreme Court appointed me as an amicus curiae. Amicus curiae is a friend of the court. So, and asked me that, please look at this postcard and find out what can be done, what should we do. So I make out a brief and go to the court. Ultimately, the court made inquiries and got reports, which was vetted by me. And I said there are broadly three pollutants. The allegations are absolutely correct that this river has really become so dirty and polluted. One was the liquor industry. The liquor industry pollutes a lot, and they would put, there is a law in place, there is a law which says that you will not pollute, or you will not throw in the river unpolluted thing, etc. But you bribe the officers who are supposed to do this under the Pollution Control Board, and that's all right, you can do what you like. The other thing was the different industries, especially sugar industries, because sugar cane is grown, and they pollute a lot. And the third was the municipal bodies. They are local bodies. They are in fact elected representatives. They are supposed to look after the various health, etc. And they do nothing. The court issued notice to all these people. And municipalities say, "What can I do? I have no money. So I have to throw unpolluted." And when you ask the state government, which is a higher the provincial government, he said, "It's not my business, it's the business of the central government." Central government said, "I'm not concerned with this, this is your business." And court then had to intervene. So this is another way of, now in public interest litigation, you don't need any particular petitioner. If the court reads in a newspaper or on TV, sees that some such thing has happened, the court on its own motion will issue orders and call the government officers, etc. So this is another. And that locus standi is not necessary. Normally, if you go to court, you must have locus to go. If I go to court, I must have suffered something, or I am going to suffer something, and therefore I can go to court. That is called locus standi, that your right to approach the court. In this public interest litigation, there is no locus standi required. All that the court sees, whether the person who has come to me has come bona fide, or he has come because he is enemy of that liquor baron and things like that, then they will not entertain. But if he has come in a bona fide way, now the another thing which United Nations has mentioned is the education. You must provide education. Now, there are people who are too poor to send their children to schools. Number two, if they would rather like a 7 or 8 year child to do some job, and when they become 10 years, they'll be working in the construction industry or making fireworks, which is a very, very dangerous thing. Then they say, what can I do? I have no money to eat myself. So unless this 8 year old boy goes out and gets something, doesn't matter, he will not be paid minimum wages, he will be paid something. Now that these are all, it's not something which is typical to India. I'm talking, this is all United Nations has laid down this, and they have of course laid down about women empowerment. Health, now you don't have doctors, you don't have medical facilities, you can't afford medical facilities. HIV, AIDS, now all these are factors which, since United Nations has laid down, I'll say it will apply to any state and every state. You know, it is, there may be, degree may be different. Some are more fortunate and the problem may be less, but it can't be that these problems are not before them. Our constitution talks of, in the preamble, to provide justice, social, political, and economic. These are the whole barometer, so whatever rights you give, there's a chapter, there are of course chapters of fundamental rights in all the constitutions. You provide that nobody will take away my property without paying me full compensation. That says you talk of rights of people, but then you have to talk of rights of people who are too poor to even claim their rights. So that's why we have got a directive principles chapter saying that these people, he cannot go to court to enforce it, but the government must proceed towards looking after the welfare of these poor people who cannot defend themselves and who cannot get. So that is how law as a social engineering is very, very necessary. And of course, fortunately, I have given my written paper, I have written down, and which I'll hand over so it can be circulated. But the rule of law also requires principles of natural justice. If a government authority wants to pass an order against Mr. X, then they must hear Mr. X. He cannot pass an order without hearing him. Now that has been expanded by our Supreme Court to a great extent. And they have brought in principles of natural justice. And natural justice has been made so wide that nobody can pass an order against you unless you get natural justice. But even natural justice was not good enough. And therefore, they have said promissory estoppel is another principle coined. So if you have promise that hereafter, if you do this, I'll do this, that it is, there is no law, but it's the promise of a minister, or a promise of a government authority who is entitled to make promise. He has made such a promise, the court will enforce that promise, and it is a sort of a subhead of a natural justice. Or even if there is no such promise, the court will expect you to behave in a way which is which creates expectation in my mind, and therefore without any specific promise, the courts have enforced this. Now let us therefore resolve that we should have common law to some extent. I mean, today is too early for us to dream of having a universal law. But on certain basic issues which affects the right life and livelihood of people who are too poor at the lowest strata of the society, I would like just to think on these lines, and therefore we all become citizens of one country, and one country is the world. And vielen Dank, euch allen.
You have written a very long paper, and it is to be able to present it in such a dense and condensed way, that is great and wonderful. It is completely exceptional, because normally professors do profit from the situation to have this place here, and they can't stop. And but you know that when you're pleading in court, you must tell a good story, and there must be somebody who listens. And so for professors, it's not necessary that somebody listens, but for a lawyer who wants to be successful, there is the need for listeners. And so thank you very, very much for that. So I understood it as that you were pleading for really for a global legal culture, if I understood right. And you were reminding us some universal principles of the law that sometimes in the debates about differences and differentiations of legal cultures and so forth, and we can define endless ways to say what the difference is between the rule of law, the Rechtsstaat concept, état de droit, and so forth. And some of us know such a lot of things about that. But sometimes we are also losing the ground and the evaluative and the value attachment and the value commitment we need. And there, the figure of justice has also a lot of meanings. But if we do get rid of it in order to deconstruct it as something that is an empty concept, also as we have done it in the history, especially of Europe, it may become dangerous. And to remind us what justice and how central it is for mankind. So I think we have to thank you for that very much. So in a way, we could say that now the floor is open for, if I understand right, for Matthias Herdegen to respond. And I don't have to present you anymore. Really, this would be a kind of a crime. I will. The Mount Sture commentary, your work, Europarecht, Bankenaufsicht, all this is known. Not so well known is your book about Rationalität und Recht from 2010. I would like to recommend it. And perhaps also for a discussion to see how to integrate the Weberian perspective, what rationalization is in that context. We have to make this discussion. And the principles of international economic law, you must explain us how people who would like to not to buy, or I don't know how, at least to take it in a legal way home, how this could be possible. Perhaps you have a recommendation how this can be done. I think it is necessary before we go down afterwards downstairs in order to have a small and humble meal together, some commensality that is so important, I think. So we'll do this later on. But I think now you have not only the right, but also the obligation, in a way, to respond to all the questions and implications that were in the debate until now. So very welcome to Matthias Herdegen, who was, since October 2012, a fellow at our center. And we are very proud that your book came out during the period that you were fellow at our center, by the way, it had to be said. So thank you very much.
Thank you much, Werner Gebhardt, for your always inspiring overtures and presentation. If I had a choice, and if you had reminded me that I always have an obligation in terms of reciprocity, if I had the choice, rather than commenting on the inspiring contributions of my distinguished friends, I would just prefer remain seated and keep on listening to all these pleasant commentaries and the sharp analysis. And now that that is done, leave the impact of your conclusions rather than diluting them by trying your patience. But as we are always reminded in this house, this is a serious center for advanced studies, and you are expected to reciprocate and to do some labor in return for all the intellectual pleasure which you receive. Though in deference to these obligations, I will make a very brief comments. But I would like briefly to repass the comments of first your overture, which harps again on a central theme of the patron saint of the center, rationality in Max Weber's terms. I think this is something which we will go on working, deconstructing of rationality, because it seems to me a key theme when we talk about the interrelation between international standards, be it human rights standards, international economic law, and diversity, cultural diversity. Merle, I can only reciprocate what you said about our good cooperation, and I hope there will be another occasion to renew it. That was really a very fruitful and way it added sweetness to the labor of writing the book and seeing it being published. Thank you very much indeed, Merle, and thank you for being there. Rudi Dolzer, dear friend and competitor, but more friend. I feel flattered that you find something of your grand design in the interplay of international trade law, investment law, and finance and monetary law reflected in this book. And indeed, it's been one of the endeavors, one of the ambitions to tie these three areas and a few others together and to show, quite along the lines of your presentation, of Erica's presentations, and what Parek just said, that the impact of international economic law goes well beyond mere trade liberalization or mere promotion and protection of investment. You, Erica, told us about the story of the SADC tribunal, the splendeur et misère of the attempt to integrate human rights and reference to the standard of the rule of law in a treaty dedicated to economic regional integration, which for the time being seems to have been frustrated. But the experience would only have been a totally depressing one if the story had stopped there. But you tell us how the story keeps going and how the fruits of this courageous approach of the Senate tribunal keep on flourishing despite the tribunal being de facto dismantled in an in legal way. And I will come several times back to your excellent presentation, Parek, your defining justice in terms of the fulfillment of rational expectations. Though we see international economic law has a strong connotation with sustainable development, even distributive justice, and possibly most important of all factors, the Rechtsstaat, justice, rule of law, buen gobierno, señor Consul General de Colombia. Though, however you call it, and that which we call an oath by any other name would smell as sweet. We are talking about the same substantive terms. The first brief contribution I want to make, or the first thesis, is the impact, the contribution of international economic law to welfare and good governance in terms of a bounded, a limited neutrality towards legal cultures. Why is it neutral, and why is this neutrality inherently limited, restrained? Criteria of rationality can operate in relatively neutral terms, respecting policy choices and established regulatory models as such. However, once a specific socio-political economic approach is taken, it is subject to this scrutiny of rationality in terms of aptness, in terms of necessity, and in terms of a proper balance between the interests involved. Standards providing for rationality become the more invasive, the more reflect a specific economic bias or a specific social bias. Now, of course, you could take an altogether different approach. You could say trade liberalization in itself is already very biased, or investment protection is already very, very, very biased. And in that way, you also have already taken an option and set a specific preference. However, we, I would at least say, most of those engaged in international income law would say this is a rational choice in the light of empirics. As we have seen, all the three main areas of international economic law, trade law, investment law, and financial and monetary law, have an impact on national legal culture. Strongest, probably, the impact of international trade law, which as Rudolzer emphasized, is the area, in fact, the only area that is truly globalized in legal terms, because we have this multilateral, quasi-universal world trade order now embracing about 150 states. We have deference in international economic law to non-protectionist economic choices. You have an ample margin of appreciation. You can pursue different political, social, and economic goals as long as you do in terms of equal competitive conditions, in terms of national treatment, in terms of non-discrimination. And then we have, as the probably most powerful tool of rationality as a standard of scrutiny, that's proportionality, which links the law together with empirically and scientifically corroborated rationality. And as such, it's neutral. You don't have any inherent cultural preferences. They only creep in once you tie proportionality with specific cultural, social, or economic preferences. Even though you can have conflicts with legal and political cultures, especially with a high degree of risk aversion as prevailing, especially in Europe, in particular in continental Europe. We are probably the area on the globe that is most risk averse. And if we are expected to submit our regulation for the safety of food in the energy sector and other areas to standards of proportionality in terms of strict empiric and scientific corroboration, we get in trouble. Because not all our expressions of risk aversion as prevailing in our societies are empirically sustained. There's a mixture of many things prevailing in large sectors of our population. We just do not want to have them, regardless of scientific standards. And I will just mention a few cases, the EC hormone cases. We just don't want to have any meat stemming from hormone-treated beef in our supermarkets. We are very reluctant to approve and to allow the marketing of biotech products. In fact, we had for 10 years a moratorium on the marketing of biotech products within the whole European Union, which amounted to a de facto prohibition of the marketing of all genetically modified products, food, feed, and seed. That is just some examples of this high risk aversion. And as the rulings of the World Trade Organization's dispute settlement body demonstrate, these regulations did not stand up to scientific scrutiny and did not meet the test of proportionality in terms of a scientifically corroborated risk analysis and risk management. And then we have legal regulation that entrenches certain assumptions. It crystallizes them and freezes them. We have that in our European Monetary Union with respect to the relation of price stability and independence of the European Central Bank, the whole system of the European system of central banks, which is based on the assumption, empirically sustained, as we believe, that there is a strict correlation between independence and stability of our money. But this assumption is no longer a mere assumption. It has been legally entrenched in the treaties. And what we are doing right now, we are extending that regime that finds its raison d'etre in this interrelation between price stability and independence to other functions of the European Central Bank, like monetary financing of indebted countries in Southern Europe, or in conferring supervisory functions as to our banks to the European Central Banks, essentially, not entirely, but essentially in terms of independence. But that is not the real mandate, and that's not why we granted the European Central Bank independence for. The German Bundesbank submitted a brief, which was supposed to be confidential, a couple of days to our constitutional court, where it just highlighted this problem, that we extend empiric assumptions, which have crystallized into law, to new powers and competences, which can no longer be based on this empiric function. And talking about culture, legal culture, we have also different stability cultures. We trying to harmonize them by having a single supervisory mechanism in our financial architectures, and of course by setting up the old system of the European Central Bank. We have similar assumptions underlying the legally entrenched correlation between economic stability and tight fiscal discipline. For example, our fiscal pact, which also tries to iron out the differences between various stability cultures within Europe. Whether this is going to work will be the fundamental question about the integrity of the European Economic and Monetary Union, not necessarily the future of the European Union as such. Then we have a bounded neutrality also in other areas. the standard of fair and equitable treatment, most prominent standard in international investment law. It is rational, it reflects the protection of legitimate expectations. It is also inspired, and I expect that Werner Gebhardt would side with me, by images of justice and fairness. And all of us, to some extent, are guided by these images. They have cultural, historic underpinnings, though we try to formulate them in terms of rationality. Thus, we have the standard of consistency. You highlighted this aspect and emphasized it. Consistency. Consistent behavior in the respect of legitimate expectations. So the famous case, Railroad Development Corporation and Republic of Guatemala. I'm no painter, though I have to rely on these little pictures, yeah? Where the government of Guatemala, after having received the benefits of the operation of the railway for many, many years, the U.S. corporation running this railway in Guatemala, they thought it would be proper in the government's interest to revoke the concession. And they invoked a little technical defect in the process of the concession agreement, and then the Court of Arbitration said, no, you cannot be hurt with that. You are stopped from lying with that. You received the benefits and the proceeds of the of this operation. Now you can't come and can be hurt years after relying on this defect, which you always had been aware of. Or we have similar cases, abrupt changes of energy policy. A very traditional view is we need standards like fair and equitable treatment that our investors from Western countries are protected in countries with a shaky implementation of the rule of law. That's been the traditional perspective. Now we see the backlash. Yeah? These standards are coming home. Rudi Dotzer knows much more about the Vattenfall case than I do, being the leading expert in investment law and investment arbitration. The abrupt turnaround of the German energy policy, yeah, in light of the nuclear catastrophe in Japan, which is not associated with a new scientific risk analysis. It's very much associated with increased risk aversion in larger and larger sectors of the German population, was the driving factor behind this abrupt changes, just after the same government and the same majority of parliament had extended the lifespan of nuclear power station, thus prompting foreign investors to invest in the operation. And Vattenfall, among others, had just done that. And months later, we just had this radical turn around. Very intriguing for us. We are so proud in this magnificent cathedral of constitutional rights, the Rechtsstaatsprinzip. It may very well be that in the end, the standards of international investment law are subtler, are more ambitious, are more far-reaching than our own constitutional standards. This is a matter of controversy. I know my friend Matthias Herdegen, expert in energy law, is also dealing with these issues, but it's an intriguing question. Then we have, as part of fair and equitable treatment, also certain standards that relate to the administration of justice. Due process and possible miscarriage of justice. The Leuven case, again, a salient example how these standards are driven home to us, have reached the Western countries. Here a conflict between a Canadian investor and the United States about a very strange handling of trial in one of the southern states in the USA. Or the Chevron case, which is still going on. There have been a number of interim judgments. Chevron is, if I recall correctly, has taken over from Texaco as to operations in Ecuador. And there have been oil spills, damages to the environment. I haven't studied the case, but I have been told that the environmental damage is quite severe indeed. Having been occasioned legally or against the law, that's a matter of debate, by Texaco. And then they are held responsible, and a court of Ecuador shelled out a judgment condemning Chevron to pay $17 billion. Then even for those accustomed to deal with considerable sums in investment law, that is a new dimension. And then Chevron now turns against Ecuador, claiming that this judgment amounts to unfair and unequitable treatment inter alia. And the government of Ecuador has problems with this. Well, it says it's not us, it's our courts. But they have problems to realize or to admit what they have realized, that a country has to stand up for any miscarriage occurring in its courts. Yeah. A very, 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 very interesting, strange case. There seems to have been massive pollution, possibly in violation of the Ecuadorian legislation, which was very lax in the beginning and has been tightened later on. And there have been strange occurrences during the process which might amount to what we call miscarriage of justice and something that's not to be reconciled with a due process before domestic courts. Then we have, as another element, transparency, especially in cases of corruption. And now we have a general principle of law recognized by arbitral tribunals that investors can never rely on a legal position, a concession, or another right that was obtained by bribery or corruption, even if at the time, that's a Kenya case, that was just local custom. This investor wanted to do business in Kenya, and he was told that everything is very difficult for a foreign investor to set up this kind of business, but there is a remedy, and if he would just assent to a meeting with the then president, the head of state, at his private home, and leave a little suitcase with $1 million, then things would run very smoothly. And indeed, the machine having been oiled, things went very smoothly until the administration changed. Though he cannot be heard saying, this conformed to local practice. I had to do it. Everybody did it. I didn't even insinuate it. They insisted, if I wanted to do business, that I pay the bribe. The reason being that in the end, you have to look behind the state as a legal person. Then they have to look at the population, in this case, one of the poorest countries. And that they are the real victims of of bribery and corruption. And that is why no investor can rely on a legal position obtained by corruption. And whether or not what he did corresponded to a habit, to a cultural habit, is absolutely irrelevant. Then we come to the interplay between international economic law and human rights standards, and the most important sequence of cases, Erica, related. And I think the aesthetic drama was right and correct, even if someone courageously, to integrate these universal human rights standards subscribed to by the parties, especially as to the prohibition of racial discrimination. The prohibition of racial discrimination is customary international law. It is even a jus cogens, and can be found in a host of international treaties. And we just have to look and see how this go on, how whether or not the domestic administration of justice to some extent can fill the gap created by the flat denial of compliance by the government of Zimbabwe and by the dismantling of the SADC tribunal. And it could be added, there have been parallel investment arbitrations, where also the tribunals held in favor of the expropriated farmers, because some of them were foreign investors. And that also shows the spillover effect of investment protection. If you have to grant a certain level of the administration of justice, of fairness, of the rule of law, you will in the end practice the same standards vis-à-vis your own citizens. Of course, in the Zimbabwean case, if you don't live up to either standards, the situation is pretty bad. But once you've lost all reputation in that area, the risk of further damage to your reputation gets smaller and smaller. All the more important the role of neighboring countries in ensuring that a minimum risk in terms of reputation, severing cooperation, and other sanctions remain. If not the governments, perhaps the courts. We have an interplay of human rights standards, although with respect to multilateral enterprises, the transnational corporations, we have now set up in the OECD countries, in a number of other cooperating countries, so-called national contact points that investigate allegations of misbehavior that German, British, French corporations engage in dealings with other corporations that employ children or that resort to forced labor or do damage to the environment, etc., etc. That's the so-called due diligence standard in your business contact and the chain of supply. Then we have another most controversial aspect in terms of bounded neutrality, bounded rationality, that the conditionality, the adjustment programs. We always thought that this is something well relevant for Argentina, possibly for Russia in the 70s or in the 80s, for Latin America, Washington consensus, which Rudy referred to. Now, the very core of the Washington consensus has reached the Club Mediterranean. Greece, Cyprus, and the other countries, of course, in a modified way. And we see the results, and also we have the trias. We have the European Commission, the Eurobank, and the International Monetary Fund. In a way, these people are acting like proconsuls, or like an economic or financial protectorate in these countries. They set standards, of course they must be agreed to by the government, and they supervise the implementation of these standards, and if they find fault with the implementation, then the next tranche will not be paid out. And this, of course, causes concern, especially highlighted in the resolution of the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe, where it complains about the impact of current austerity programs on democratic and social standards. This could have been written a couple of decades ago by the Congreso of Argentina. That's not the Argentinian Congress. It's the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe. It's not 1970 or 1980, that's 2012. And they invoke as a contrarevision the general principles of a social market economy. Now, of course, the, what we call a social market economy depends on the vision of the spectator. It's a bit like an eel. It's very difficult to grasp, and it very strongly builds also on images of what is social. It makes or tends to make us ignore that the harsher version of the social market economy is provides the very basis for the financial support of these ailing countries. Had we followed the same chimeric vision of paradise, social market economy without any austerity, Germany and other countries would be in no position at all, and there would be no political will in any parliament to grant these guarantees and financial support, nor would there be the financial ability to do so. So there are always different sides when we talk about cultural diversity and, to some extent, legal cultures. Of course, the two are interplayed, at least in a democratic order, because prevailing societal perceptions drive majority decisions, which then become law. So it's not surprising that in many contexts we look how to grant some deference to cultural diversity. Recalling the permanent theme of sovereignty. Sovereignty has many connotations. It may be a very defensive attitude towards all kinds of international standards. But it may also be something that is connotated with the democratic underpinnings of political choices. Though we have in the World Trade System the Cartagena Protocol on biosafety, with this, well as to the approval for import of genetically modified organisms, the state parties may rely on socio-economic considerations as opposed to strictly scientific criteria. And we do the same thing within the European Union when we try to restrain the marketing of certain products to the extent that this restraint is not strictly empirically sustained but founded on socio-economic aversions in our societies. Though this clause is the result of a political alliance of the European Union and a number of African and also some Latin American countries that felt uneasy about the standard of strict rationality, strict scientific justification for all restrictive measures. And then, most prominently, we have the deference to public morals in the World Trade System, in the GATS, the General Agreement on Tariff Trades, and the Sister Agreement on the Trade in Services, which states that nothing in this agreement shall be construed to prevent the adoption or enforcement by any member of measures necessary to protect public morals or to maintain public order. Now in our law schools, it's very difficult to tell people what public morals are. And if there are any public morals that are distinct from legal standards, most answers you would get from your students refer to something they consider wrong that's already legally prohibited. Though we had to await, and the same would apply to other to most other members, and there wouldn't be great moral conflicts under the old World Trade Order. So we had to wait until China, People's Republic of China, acceded to the World Trade Union, and they have a specific vision to public morals and find it a very important tool to stabilize their system in social terms, their social system, but also their political system. As to books, video cassettes, all other DVDs being imported, and about these things which are imported from the United States, from Europe, you never know. They may transport and convey contents which disturb people, which make them reflect critically upon what the government tells them as the proper attitude. Yeah. If you import a novel that describes the pleasures of large families on 19th century. Of large families, well, that wouldn't concord with the one-child policy in China, and all other disturbing materials that might be transported. Though they invented a system of controlling the marketing through state agencies or joint ventures controlled by Chinese partner, etc., etc. And here the dispute settlement body held, the panel and the appellate body held in interpreting the notion of public morals, that this must be very broadly understood. Yeah? That in fact it's to some extent a self-touching terms. States may to some extent define what they understand by public morals in the light of changing historic, social, economic contexts. Having done that, however, they must apply these standards in a rational and proportional way, and that's where the Chinese system was considered as being in violation of the treaties. We have other discussions which I will just briefly refer to. Is child labor a moral issue as to imported products? Animal welfare, a pending dispute which we have as to a European Union regulation as to seal products. Yeah. So not only risk aversion, but animal welfare ranks very high in European society, in European regulation, and this also generates conflicts, and we will see that the European Union can rely on public morals in order to define, to justify this restrictive measure for the marketing of seal products. I will now conclude with just two or three observations as to fundamental rights interpretation of international rules in light of legal culture. We had this ruling of the European Court of Justice on patents on embryonic stem cell procedures. Yeah. Where the European Court of Human Rights held that patents involving human stem cells should not be granted, they would be a violation of public morals, because they involve the use of human embryos produced in vitro fertilization, and that would violate human dignity. A strange ruling, because implementing the invention is something perfectly legal. It's legal in the UK, where you can produce these stem cells. It's legal in Germany, where Brustle, who is a famous neurologist here in the University of Bonn, yeah, can import these stem cells perfectly legally. So what these people are doing is perfectly legal. Still, the patent they obtain is considered a violation of public morals. Very strange, probably in violation of world trade law. Or we have other issues, and Herrick already referred to that, patents with respect to pharmaceutical products. We have the medical decision of the members, where they say we want the trade agreement on the protection of intellectual property to be understood that it allows members large discretion in implementing the agreement so as to assure a proper access of the public to medicines for all. And the Kleber case has already been dealt with in your very fine presentation, Pravin, and I will just quote one little passage. It's about, as you say, it's about the attempt of Novartis to have a kind of evergreening a patent by saying, well, we invented something additional. Now it's with this new invention, you can store this cancer drug for a longer period of time. And the Supreme Court found, in my view very convincingly, there was really nothing novel and new about this innovation, and the that the impact had no therapeutic added value. And the background is the following reasoning. They say, we have referred to this international trade agreement on patents as being the cause of a good deal of concern, not only in this country, but also in other parts of the world. The concern being that patent protection to pharmaceutical and agricultural chemical products might have the effect of putting life-saving medicines beyond the reach of a very large section of the people. Now, the result of this reasoning is just a strict construction of the rules on novelty, with the effect that in this specific case, Novartis cannot claim a patent on which it would like to have seen evergreened. And I will just conclude with an integrative approach which has already been highlighted by Rudy Dolzer and by Erika and Pravin. I think it would be mistaken to qualify certain international regimes as the human rights as the good regime, and the international economic law just as a vehicle, a tool for imposing a neoliberal model eroding social cultural diversity. But it's all the more important that the actual international economic order has now covered a long way in integrating the rules on trade law, on investment law, on the financial architecture, and on monetary law, on one hand, and human rights standards and environmental protection on the other. And I believe that this integrative approach, which Rudy has highlighted, seems to me the proper way of enhancing the legitimacy of international economic law and its principles. Let me just conclude with a final word. I think what we celebrate this afternoon is not so much a book and even less an author. What we celebrate is rather a common ground among us. That is the endeavor to meet the challenge, always fascinating and always intriguing, how to strike the proper balance between global standards, possibly even global moral sentiment on one hand, and deference to regional and local diversity and specific ways of life on the other. I take much pride in sharing this noble task with you present. I am aware that it takes more than just an academic bond to share this evening and this afternoon. Therefore, I'm not reluctant. I'm not shy enough to take it as your presence, as a testimony also of friendship, especially of those who have traveled from various corners of Europe or even from Delhi or Pretoria. Let me thank all of you. I feel honored and I feel proud, and I want to thank you for all your contributions. Thank you much indeed.
So after this wonderful talk, relating, by the way, to the main topics of the center in a very convincing way, at least to me, and showing how diversity and universality might go together, but on grounds of very precise juristic questions and ways to deal with them, I think we feel, I at least feel very much inspired, and I would like to stay for at least more than 4 and perhaps even 5 hours. For those who won't be with us for this project, we have prepared something downstairs. At least that means to share, to be in commensality. Commensality, what means, it's not the same as intermarriage, but it has to do with building a community, and building a community perhaps in the spirit that you were evoking in your last sentences, that this international economic law is not something so far away from our everyday life experiences and our concerns, perhaps about the environment, humanitarian law questions, and so forth, but that it makes part of a whole and of the normative order we are fighting for, perhaps one that might bring to another kind of societal orders. So this is a lot of open questions, but I'm very sure that we will continue to discuss them, perhaps in other contexts with the editor present here, in other constellations, that, for example, next week or in 2 weeks, I have to go there, to the next topic, Recht und Kultur, a very interesting colleague from Passau, an Americanist, will talk about Recht und Kultur. And then finally, the law and religion from a sociological perspective, joint conference of the Section for Sociology of Law and the Section for Sociology of Religions of the German Sociological Association, though it is international also in its content and in its perspective. Once again, it's difficult to find the last word, but I have to do it now, really. And I have to say, please come back. Thank you for having been with us, and join us for having dinner together on the first floor of this building. Thank you very much once again, especially for having written this book. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here in this constellation. Yeah? That's the very reason for that. Thank you once again.